Welcome back, Lifesavers, for another NCLEX preparation video. In today's video, we are going to be covering the Fetal Development and APGAR Newborn Assessment Score Scale. As a woman progresses through her pregnancy, her tiny little microscopic embryo will go through very rapid and dramatic changes within the first few months of gestation. There are 10 key milestones that you'll want to familiarize yourself with while you're preparing for your NCLEX, and we're going to review them now. So the first major milestone of the fetal development occurs at the fourth week of gestation. At this week, most women don't even realize that they are pregnant yet. They are likely just a few days late on their menstrual cycle, and they may be considering taking a home pregnancy test. However, their little embryo is busy doing some amazing things in mama's uterus. So during the fourth week of gestation, the embryo spinal cord is formed and fused at the midpoint. Their body and head can now fold forward, and the head is the most prominent part of the embryo's tiny body. The back is bent, which makes the head almost touch the tail. A prominent bulge appears, which would later form as the heart. The arms and legs are bud-like little structures at this point. And the eyes and ears and nose are there, but they're barely recognizable. So basically, the little embryo looks like a frog tadpole at this point. The next major milestone of development will occur at the eighth week of gestation. By this week, orangiogenesis is achieved and complete. So what does that mean? Well, this means that the three germ layers, the ectoderm, endoderm, and mesoderm, are actually formed, which is necessary for the internal organs to start developing and growing. The heart at this stage has already developed a septum and valves and is beating rhythmically. And the arms and legs have developed and facial features are now noticeable. The genitals start to form, but they're not quite yet recognizable. The intestine is rapidly growing, and by this point, most women will have a very strong suspicion of pregnancy because they would have missed their menstrual cycle and likely would have had a positive home pregnancy test. Results of an ultrasound would show a gestational sac at this point, which actually confirms the pregnancy. At this stage, the embryo will go from resembling a tadpole to more so resembling a little gummy bear. The next milestone occurs at the 12th week of gestation. So by this week, the embryo is now referred to as a fetus, and at the end of this week, that's actually when the first trimester will come to an end. The fetus's toes and fingers already have nail beds. Faint fetal movements are starting, although mama won't yet be able to feel them. Early reflexes are now present. Tooth buds are forming along the formation of bone ossification centers. So as the embryo's cartilage starts to break down, osteoblasts will penetrate the disintegrating cartilage and replace it with that spongy, soft bone. The genitals are now recognizable through its appearance, but you likely can't be able to visualize it 100% on an ultrasound just yet. Urine secretion begins, but it's not yet evident, and the heartbeat could be detected by a non-invasive fetal Doppler. The next milestone is at the 16th week of gestation. So at this stage of fetal development, an ordinary stethoscope could actually detect the fetus's heartbeat by placing it on mom's belly. And lanugo has started to form, which is that unpigmented hair, and it can be found everywhere on a baby's body except for the palms, the lips, and soles of the feet. The pancreas and liver are also beginning to form at this stage. Urine is now present in the amniotic fluid, and the fetus starts to practice swallowing by gulping that amniotic fluid. And this is also the week that an ultrasound could determine the sex of the fetus with pretty good certainty. The next milestone is the 20th week of gestation. So by now, the mother can possibly sense some of those spontaneous fetal movements. There is also hair formation on the head all the way down to the eyebrows, and the fetus continues to develop. They will begin losing that forehead hair as they progress through the pregnancy. The upper intestines contain meconium, which is known as the baby's first stool. The brown fat starts to form behind the kidneys, the sternum, and the posterior neck. And a thick white coating begins to form, which is actually called the vernix. So the vernix's main job is to cover and protect the skin. Also, passive antibody transfer from mom to baby begins, which will help to start strengthening the baby's immune system. And the sleep and activity patterns for the fetus are now evident. So mom will actually start to notice patterns of movement at certain times of the day, and then they'll be followed by periods of rest where she doesn't feel a lot of baby activity. Next, we have the 24th week of gestation. So at this stage, lung surfactant begins to develop, which helps to lower surface tension in the baby's lungs and keep those alveoli from collapsing after exhalation. And that makes breathing much easier. Meconium is now present at the rectum instead of higher up in the intestine. The eyebrows and eyelashes are now distinguishable. The eyelids can now open, the pupils react to light, and the fetus can now respond to sudden sounds. The fetus also has reached the age of viability, which means that they could actually survive externally if mom went into preterm labor. The next milestone starts in the third trimester and is in the 28th week of gestation. So surfactant at this stage is demonstrated inside the amniotic fluid because as the baby starts practicing their breathing, they expel that excess surfactant into the amniotic fluid. The alveoli are also starting to mature again because the baby is actually practicing their breathing. If the baby is a boy, then the testicles have now descended into the scrotal sac. And lastly, the retinal blood vessels in the eyes start to form, but they are highly susceptible to damage at this point. Okay, so we're winding down to our last three fetal stages. The next stage is that 32nd week of gestation. So at this stage, subcutaneous fat is deposited, so the baby is starting to plump up more and more. The fetus also responds to sounds outside the mother's body through movements. At this stage, the active MARA reflex, or also known as the startle reflex, is now present, which makes the baby respond to sudden sounds. Iron stores are also now starting to develop, and fingernails are starting to grow. The next milestone is the 36th week of gestation. So during this milestone, deposits of iron, carbohydrates, calcium, and glycogen stores are in the body. The baby continues to plump up more and more as subcutaneous fats are now deposited. One or two creases are present at the soles of the foot, and that lanugo that we talked about a little bit ago, the baby's first hair, it actually starts to diminish. And at this point, some babies turn and assume that vertex position, which means that the baby is now head down and they're getting ready for delivery. And finally, the last milestone that you'll need to be aware of when preparing for your NCLEX occurs at the 40th week of gestation. So the fetus now kicks very actively and hard enough to cause discomfort to the mother. You can even see the baby's movements from the outside, which is pretty cool to see. And at this stage, the fetal hemoglobin is being converted to adult hemoglobin, and the vernix, that thick white protective skin covering, is now fully formed. The fingernails also extend to the fingertips, and the soles of the feet have now two creases that cover at least 2/3 of the surface. Okay, so now that we've covered all 10 of the key fetal development stages, what happens when this little miracle is born? Well, immediately after the baby is born, this is considered a very critical transition time because the baby is learning to adjust and adapt to earthside living versus living in the mother's uterus. So it's critical that you, as the nurse, learn and understand how to monitor and assess the baby immediately after birth using a scoring scale called the APGAR Newborn Assessment Score Scale. And just a fun little fact for you, did you know that Dr. Virginia APGAR created the system in 1952 and used her name as a mnemonic for each of the five categories that a person will score? So the mnemonic in the APGAR stands for activity or muscle tone, pulse, grimace, appearance or color, and respirations. Isn't that so funny how that worked out? Okay, so let's talk a little more in detail about this ironically clever scoring scale and how you will use it to assess the newborn's transition into life. So the APGAR scoring system is divided into five categories that I had just mentioned, and each category receives a score of 0 to 2 points. At most, a child will receive is an overall score of 10. However, a baby rarely receives a score of a 10 in the first few moments of life, and that's because babies have blue hands or feet immediately after birth, which is totally normal and will quickly resolve within the first few minutes after the baby takes a few really good, deep first breaths. All right, so let's look at each category in this mnemonic to understand a little more about how the newborn is scored. So A for activity or muscle tone. So they get 0 points if the baby is limp or floppy, 1 point if the limbs are flexed, and 2 points if the baby is active and has movement in all extremities. P for pulse or heart rate. 0 points if the pulse is absent, 1 point if the pulse is less than 100 beats per minute, and then 2 points if the pulse is greater than 100 beats per minute. G for grimace or response to stimulation such as suctioning the baby's nose. So they get 0 points if it's absent, 1 point for facial movement or grimace with stimulation, and 2 points for cough, sneeze, or cry and withdrawal of the foot when you stimulate that foot. A for appearance or color, so 0 points if the baby is blue or bluish gray or pale all over, 1 point for a pink body but blue extremities, and 2 points if the baby is pink all over. And R for respiration or breathing, so they get 0 points if breathing is absent, 1 point for irregular or weak crying, and 2 points for a good strong cry. The APGAR scores are recorded at 1 and 5 minutes, and this is because if a baby's scores are low at 1 minute, a medical team will likely intervene or they'll increase the interventions that have already been started. At 5 minutes, the baby has ideally improved, but if the score is still really low after 5 minutes, then the medical team may reassess the score after 10 minutes, or they may go ahead and take the baby right to the NICU. And doctors do expect that some babies may have lower APGAR scores after they're born. So these newborns that may have lower scores include premature babies, babies that are born by cesarean section delivery, or babies who had complicated deliveries. So what is considered a normal or abnormal APGAR score? Well, a score of 7 to 10 after 5 minutes is reassuring, and a score of 4 to 6 is considered moderately abnormal. A score of 0 to 3 is very concerning, and it indicates a need for increased intervention, usually in assistance for breathing. A patient may see nurses drying off a child vigorously or delivering oxygen by a mask. And sometimes a doctor, midwife, or nurse practitioner may recommend transferring a patient to a neonatal intensive care nursery for further assistance. And I actually experienced this with my little guy after he was born. It was such a scary, traumatic experience, especially for a new first-time mom. After delivery, he wasn't crying. His whole body was blue. He was limp and floppy and wasn't responding to very much stimuli. So if we're using the APGAR scoring assessment, I would probably rate him as a 2 immediately after birth, because I knew from the scalp monitor that he had on, his heart rate was above 100. But after about a minute, he started with a very weak cry and his color returned just slightly. But at that point, the doctors had already called in the NICU team to assess him, and they took him from me within a few seconds after his birth. And he ended up being diagnosed with delayed transitioning, and he spent a day and a half in the NICU. But now, don't worry, he is a perfectly healthy, thriving, almost 9-month-old chunky boy. So he made it through, but it's very, very scary. I was so, so thankful that the nurses and doctors kept me informed about everything that they were doing, and they kept reassuring me that he would be okay. So the best advice I can give you as a new nurse, if you decide to go into labor and delivery, is just to be aware of the fact that you have 2 patients after a newborn is born. You have the baby and the mother. So make sure you try to keep the mom informed as best that you can while you're caring for the most precious thing that she will ever have in her entire life. And that concludes the end of this lesson. I hope that you found this information extremely valuable and it made you just a little more confident as you prepare to take your NCLEX. I just want to thank you so much again, Lifesavers, for tuning in today. My name is Nurse Kelly Tyrrell, and I help nurses feel more confident, increase their test scores, and retain what they don't remember in nursing school. If this video helped you in any way, be sure to give it a thumbs up. Also, don't forget to smash that subscribe button and click that notification bell so you don't miss out on any of my upcoming content and future videos. And why don't you go ahead and do me a favor and drop me a comment below. Just let me know where you're at with your nursing journey. I'd love to say hi and just connect with you. Also, make sure you click that share icon to spread the word and encourage a fellow aspiring nurse. And last but not least, when you are ready to take your NCLEX, be sure to check out my NCLEX and Chill review, where I help eliminate test anxiety and review detailed test-taking strategies so you can have that unfair advantage to pass your exam on your very next attempt. Not ready to end the study sesh yet? Well, you are in luck, because if you stick around, you can watch more of my videos coming at you in 3, 2, 1. Bye, lifesavers.